twice before thrilled us with his story. He is the author of Bloodline of the Holy Grail, which traces the messianic bloodline from the life of Jesus to the current day and that impact and influence on the royal sovereign houses of Europe. And the question always was what made that bloodline so important? And so the next book that he's going to be doing, which he's about halfway through, is the reasons why that bloodline was so important. And tonight he's going to discuss that with you and tell you why that was. Please welcome Sir Laurence Gardner.
To be home. I gather from the hands that went out that I'm about 50-50 on the audience or something. Those have heard me before. The plan will be the same. The subject matter will be different. In essence, we'll be looking strictly at history, but history viewed from a perspective that's different to the norm. Just to reiterate, those who weren't here before, history is not the event. History is the record of the event. History is written for all sorts of reasons. It's generally written by its winners. And as with all things, the stories of yesterday as today, we are told what we're supposed to know, and we learn it in the way that we're supposed to learn it. History may be, but it may not be, the truth. It's written for political reasons, it's written for reasons of vested interests, they may be parliamentary, they may be church interests, or whatever. And to pass our exams, we have to learn and answer our questions in a certain way. Does not make it the truth. Well, it's been a year since Bloodline of the Holy Grail was published. Those of you who did hear my early talks will know that the book is essentially, as Greg said, about the messianic bloodline as it's descended from Jesus Christ to the present day. It was concerned and is concerned with comparing the New Testament gospels that we know today with the original first-hand accounts of the period, whether they be the Jewish records or the Roman chronicles themselves. So this is the first lesson to learn in history, that for the most part, the people who knew more about what they were talking about were the people who were there at the time, not those that decided to interpret it a few hundred years later. It's rather like the art critic who tells us what the artist really meant to say, when actually the artist knows best. So, what we did in Bloodline and in talks that we did earlier this year was to just look at the way that the Christian church had established itself, how it had molded itself around a certain field of vested interest, most of which was to suppress the female in the church establishment, and because the church reigned supreme for so many hundreds of years, also in society as a whole. What we find when we look at the original texts of the era is quite a different story generally from those stories that we know today. Doctrines such as Jesus was born of a virgin, that he was the one and only Son of God, such things as these do not feature at all in the documents of the era. The New Testament actually gives details of Jesus' descendant lineage from David of Israel, King David, and the kings of Judah. And this has led to the one question that I've been asked more than any other in the last year, and that is, okay, this is an important bloodline. It's the bloodline from Jesus. It has a big story to tell in history of the Western world and in the Middle Eastern world. But why on earth was it so special to begin with? It cannot be special simply because it came from King David. It clearly isn't special because it came from Jesus, because before that it did come from King David. The New Testament tells us that it did. history tells us it did, and actually the Roman archives tell us that it did, because it was they that purloined an edict from the emperor to collect all documentation concerning messianic line in AD 70. Most of these records are still held. They weren't destroyed as they were supposed to be. So the question is simply, what was so important about the bloodline? What made King David so important in the first place? And this is the trail that I was led on for the next book. And I'm probably about halfway through it now, as Greg said. I'm not going to start the story from the very beginning of it, because what I'm here to talk to you today is just about that one aspect of it. The Bible explains that the line that moved through the Old Testament story to King David, etc., was important because it began with Adam and Eve, first people, from whose third son, Seth, evolved a line which progressed through characters like Methuselah and Noah, down to Abraham, who became a great patriarch of the Hebrew nation. It relates that Abraham brought his family out of Mesopotamia, Iraq, into Canaan, Palestine, we came to know it, and the descendants then moved into Egypt and stayed there for a few generations, came back to the land of Canaan again, and so the story progresses. And if we view it just as we're told it, it's in fact quite a fascinating saga, but there is nothing anywhere in it to explain to us why this line was so special. Quite the reverse is in fact the case. The ancestors are portrayed really as a sort of nomadic wandering band of territory seekers who appear to be of no real significance whatever, apart from the fact that somebody decided to write up this story. They bear no comparison to the great pharaohs of Egypt of time. The only consolation lies in the fact that from the time of Abraham, we're told that these were God's chosen people. That's a quandary sort of situation, because according to the scriptures, the God who chose them led them through nothing but a whole succession of famines and wars and hardships. And on the face of it, the line not only doesn't look special, it doesn't actually look to have been too bright. So we're faced with a couple of possibilities here. Either David was not from this Abraham succession at all, or the story that we've been presented with is quite corrupted from the original tale. The version that we have of the story may be, just like the Christian story, adapted to suit the Jewish faith rather than to suit historical fact. So in consideration of this, I was reminded of exactly what had happened with my previous book, with the New Testament story. The Gospels that have been in the public domain for centuries bear little relation to the first-hand accounts of the period. The New Testament was concocted by the 4th century bishops to support the newly contrived Christian belief. What if the Jews had done exactly the same with the Old Testament, contrived it to suit the Jewish belief? So in this regard, it's interesting to note that although the New Testament was put together only 1,600 years ago, the Old Testament, the one that tells the story from before, is actually 400 years younger than that in the form that we know it. It's based on Hebrew texts from the 10th century, just 150 years before William the Conqueror invaded England. So this is hardly first-hand accounts of anything. So I had to get back to the old writings once again, and this time we're really looking at old writings. The problem was that even if they proved to be available, the original Hebrew texts, which were rehashed centuries later in the 10th century, were themselves only written between the 6th and the 1st centuries BC. So it wasn't actually likely that even they were going to be that authentic in their telling of history from thousands of years before. The first group of books for the Old Testament was written while the Jews were held captive in the Babylon in the 6th century BC in Mesopotamia. So it was apparent that Babylon in the 6th century BC was where the records were probably held that gave the writers the information from which to put together the Old Testament. From the time of Abraham back to Adam, we have 19 generations in the Bible, and it would appear that the whole of the story of those 19 generations was all Mesopotamian. It was all Iraqi history. The interesting thing that I found was that when getting back into old Babylonian records, was that there was a great tract of southern Iraq bordering the Persian Gulf in a land that they then called Shumah, which actually in the old documents is referred to as the Eden. Not the Garden of Eden, simply the Eden. And the Eden meant it in the language of the day, a pasture land, a terrain of grazing country. I found when researching for Bloodline of the Holy Grail that good sources of background information were the texts that were not selected for the New Testament. Not the ones that are, ones that weren't. Why weren't they? What did they say that we weren't supposed to know? Perhaps I thought the same might apply to the Old Testament. Maybe the secret here is in the books that were written down at the time from the Babylonian records, but weren't ever put into print for our eyes in later times. So I looked for the books that were there, but weren't included. And it's pretty easy to find a number of them. The books of Enoch and Jubilees, for example, with which you may be quite familiar. They're currently in print. They're in the public domain. They're just not in the Bible. Another book which I'd known about for some time because I talked about it in Bloodline was the book Jasher. Another very important book. It's so important that twice in the Old Testament our attention is drawn to the great importance of the book of Jasher. It's not there. It's very important, but they missed out. That book is still readily available today. So there's not going to be too many big secrets there. There are a few. It tells a very good story about the time of the Israelites in Egypt and their return with Moses to the land of Canaan and that part of the story. But it tells us nothing at all of any consequence about the early line, the early line from Adam or from wherever we're going to go. My attention was suddenly drawn as I plowed through the Old Testament to other books which, in speaking to people, not many people had ever heard of before, and they didn't even know they were in the Bible. It says in the book of Numbers, "Wherefore it is said, in the book of the wars of Jehovah." Subsequently, in the book of Isaiah, we read, "Seek ye out the book of the Lord." Nobody had ever heard of these books, the book of the wars of Jehovah, the book of the Lord. What on earth were they? Do they exist? Well, in fact, remnants of them do still exist. What transpired was on pursuing the remnants of these books, and indeed the very substance of the Babylonian and Mesopotamian records that were put together for the Old Testament, was that the answer to one question became very clear indeed. It is said and asked many, many times by many people, how on earth is it that this God of the Hebrews, who chose them to be his people, led them through trials and tribulations and floods and famines, when from time to time, with quite a contrary personality, he appears to have done some pretty nice, merciful things? There's a conflict there, a conflict of personality, which has never really been understood. Well, looking at the old records, looking at the remnants of these two books that are mentioned, we suddenly discover why they weren't included in the Old Testament, because they make it absolutely and abundantly clear that there was a distinct difference between the figures of Jehovah and the Lord. They were in fact quite separate deities. The God referred to as Jehovah turns out to be a storm god, a god of wrath, a god of vengeance. The other god referred to throughout the original text always as the Lord was different. He was a fertility god, a god of wisdom. So we begin to see from these texts how the different personalities are answering the question, how was he one thing on the one hand and something quite different on the other? We're dealing with two different characters here in terms of the history written down at the time. So who was the Lord? In fact, what was the word he was called by at the time that would have been turned into Lord in the English language? Well, the word in Old Hebrew was Adonai. And in the Old Text, he's also always referred to by the Hebrews as Adonai. The other God is referred to as Jehovah. The strange thing is that the name Jehovah does not appear at all. Once one begins to get back to the sort of turn of that millennium into the BC years, the further we get back, and we don't have to go too far before the name Jehovah disappears from sight altogether. And the name that we begin to see is the name that Abraham referred to, the God figure, in the book of Exodus or Numbers, I can't remember which one, but he calls him El Shaddai. Suddenly Jehovah has disappeared and become this other person. El Shaddai, the texts tell us, means lofty mountain. Maybe lord of the mountain, ruler of the mountain. Whatever the words, a mountain god. What about the name Jehovah? Where did that come from? It came, as we're told in the Bible, from a quotation. It means, I am that I am. And that was a statement meant to be said to Moses by God on the mountain. I am that I am. That was when Moses actually asked him who he was. Well, that leads one to wonder, because why would Moses have asked him who he was? I mean, it would have been pretty clear that God was God, but Moses wasn't sure. He was really saying, which one have I got here? So without wishing to give the game away, he didn't really admit to too much. He just simply said, I am that I am, and but one of us can say that. It means very little. Jehovah is not a name at all. The name to Abraham and the people of the time was El Shaddai. His opposer, the one that was called the Lord in the Old Text, was called Adonai. And respectively in the land of Canaan, we find identical stories coming up. They follow exactly the same pattern. They take us through the same sequence of events. They tell the same sagas. And they are called El Elyon and Baal. They mean exactly the same things. El Elyon means mountain lord, and Baal means lord, means Adonai. Two characters still. The definitions of God and Lord as ending up in the Old Testament being mixed together throughout, as if we've got one character in this story, turn out to be totally wrong. It is a complete concoction of two quite different characters merged into one figure, hence the conflict of personalities. One was a vengeful God, a people hater. The records are very clear in this regard. The other was a social God, a people supporter. They each had wives, they each had sons and daughters. The writings tell us that throughout the patriarchal era, the Israelites endeavored to support the Adonai, the Lord. All of the early stories tell of them trying to support the Adonai, the Lord. And at every step and turn of the way, the Jehovah figure is there, the storm god, retaliating with floods and famines and tempests and destruction and just about everything that can possibly be put in the way of these people trying to follow the other guy. Even at the very last, at about 600 BC and nearer to our time than that, the Bible explains that Jerusalem was overturned by invasion, strictly at Jehovah's bidding, and Jews in their tens of thousands were taken into captivity simply because, and this is the only reason given for all of that, the Israelites had erected temples to the Lord Baal. What we have is vengeance once again. Now, it's during this time of captivity, all of these decades in Babylon, as the generations lived and died and the new ones grew up, that the Jews finally decided that all of these generations of trials and torments and famine and whatever wasn't really a great scene. Maybe we should get on this guy's side. So it was then, and only then, that suddenly we discover that Jehovah is taken on board as the God, And it's at that time that it is said that he chose us to be his people. It's the other way around, actually, but that's the way we get told the story. This is only about 500 years or so before the time of Jesus Christ. So the true story of the Jews and Jehovah and the chosen people is really quite young. It's not, it doesn't go way, way back to the time of Adam and Eve, not even the time of Abraham. They were actually following a different God. So the Jews take Jehovah on board as the main God. They decide, out of fear for the peril of everything, that this is the God they're now going to follow. The Christian church then, in a vague replication of that, eventually takes on the epitome of the same God. It doesn't call him Jehovah, it just simply calls him God, which is pretty inspirational. And it's at that time that we suddenly find that Baal and Adonai and other names disappear. They are not being followed anymore. What we now have from that moment in time, we've now moved forward into the current common era, to faiths of fear. So where does that leave us? It leaves us knowing that within a general pantheon of gods and goddesses, of which many are named in the Bible, that there were actually two predominant male god figures who in different cultures have been called El Elyon and Baal, El Shaddai and Adonai, Mazdoa, Ahriman, Jehovah and Lord, God and Father. But what we know is that by whatever name these are called, we're dealing all the time with two different characters. One cannot mix up in the old books the name Jehovah with the name Lord. And if one now reads the Old Testament with that in mind, not the English version, the Jewish translated version of the Old Testament, and just supplements the names each time, we suddenly find that every time something nasty happens, it is Jehovah, and every time something nice happens, it's this guy they call the Lord. It's not the same fellow. So who were they? They have all of these names, but these names all mean the same thing. One way or another, they mean ruler of a mountain or Lord. Did they actually have names? Well, to find out that, we've got to look back a little further, and again, we've got to stay in Babylonia, perhaps more generally in Mesopotamia, to follow the story back, because these same gods were followed from country to country as the Adamite family progressed. We can find the first clue in documents that were discovered not until 1929 in Syria. And these documents actually tell us that the two gods had their joint seats in the Tigris-Euphrates Valley. So we're back where we know that the story should begin. We're in southern Iraq. We're in the land that was then called Shumer. What did these people call the same gods? Can we find implications of the stories so that we know we're actually talking about the same gods? And we can. We can find the stories turning up in exactly the same way with the same gods. They tell us that the God we know and got to know as Jehovah was called Ilu-Kergal. Ilu-Kergal. It means ruler of the mountain. He was also called, as a sort of abbreviated form of that, Enlil. He had a brother. And his brother had probably the most important name that we can find in the history of deity, because it's really where the whole thing began. And in English, his brother's name was Archetype. The name in those days was Enki. It means archetype. Very important word. Texts inform us that it was Enlil who brought the flood, that it was Enlil who destroyed Ur and Babylon, that it was Enlil who constantly opposed the education and enlightenment of humankind. Syrian texts tell us that it was Enlil who obliterated the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah in later times on the Dead Sea because, it said, they were great centers of wisdom and learning. It's not what we get told, is it? We get told they were dens of debauchery. Well, in fact, one only has to look at the way the church is run today, that to discover anybody who thinks something different to the dogma is running a den of debauchery. We get called heretics and all sorts of names that happened at Sodom and Gomorrah. So it's Enki now, we discover, on the other hand, who's doing the other stuff. He, despite this wrath and vengeance of the brother figure, is granting Sumerians access to the tree of knowledge, to the tree of life. He sets up the escape strategy during the flood. He passed over the time-honored tablets of destiny, the tablets of scientific law, the bedrock of the early mystery school. So this establishes a scene. It's somewhere for us to begin. What we is that history isn't always history as we perceive it. We have to get back to the old records, and generally, it doesn't matter what century we look at, the original story written down by the people closest to the event is different and probably stands more chance of being correct. Without being a time traveler with a video recorder, we can't prove anything, but we can trust their writings better than we can trust some interpretations of the 10th century. Back then, we come to Yelm here in April this year, when I was over, and I was talking to Jay-Z about the plan for this next book, and talking about where I'd got so far with this story. And we got onto the subject of the early mystery schools, and it became very, very apparent that outside of pure historical record, the ancient mystery schools of the region of Egypt and Mesopotamia, Canaan, probably held more of the secrets that we had to get to grips with. As far as I could determine, and I'm looking for a route to speciality in the bloodline here, it seemed very, very apparent from everything that we could read in the text to that point, that whenever one was talking about this particular bloodline, the bloodline that came down to David and eventually to Jesus, had something rather strange and rather different about its dietary structure. There was clearly a line being built up, a line being purposely contrived for some reason or purpose, whatever, and its diet was different. There were bodily supplements being used that the words meant nothing in the text. I hadn't got a clue then what they were about. And so I was talking to Jay-Z about this, and she, with the wisdom of Mrs. Enki, said, "Fear not, because you will very soon meet the people who might have some of the answers." Well, I thought, that's pretty good. And I thought she was going to take me into the dining room and introduce me to somebody, but wasn't quite like that. Within a week and a half of getting back to Britain, lo and behold, quite out of the blue, contact was made. And they'd never heard of Jay-Z. I'm affiliated, for those of you that don't know too much about me, to an organization called the European Council of Princes. It's a constitutional body. It comprises 33 sovereign houses. And it really operates as a sort of parliamentary buffer between dictates and what people will or will not be subjected to. I was approached simply because of that, not because of my new book, by an organization that I'd never heard of before, considering all of my years of involvement. I'd never heard of them. And they were called the Imperial Court of the Dragon Sovereignty. The only thing that I knew about them was that they had existed a few hundred years ago, and I knew that they were centered in Hungary. What I discovered was that they were still very operative now, and they are still centered in Hungary. Their story, however, is much, much older, and this became terribly intriguing. Those of you who read books about ancient lore and mystery schools and Freemasonry and all this sort of thing will know about the Hermetic schools, the earliest schools in ancient Egypt from the time of Thutmosis III. He ruled in about 450 BC, and we know then that there were scientific academies that had apparently great secrets. What we're not told is that the mystery schools that Thutmosis inherited were actually schools founded by the priests of Ra in about 2200 BC, and the senior of these mystery schools was called the Sovereign Court of the Dragon. We actually have here the oldest single scientific mystery school in the world. What were the earliest aims and ambitions of the order? See here, they said, this is what we were set up to do, and this comes from 2000 BC, to perpetuate and advance the scientific strength of the royal family. Now, we're looking here, apparently, at the royal family in Egypt. But once one gets into the genealogy, we can find that that same family was the family that were the great kings in Iraq earlier. The picture begins to emerge. Yeah, there's something special here. There's something so special here that they set up royal courts and orders to look after the formulation of this family. Nothing is said to me then about diets or bodily supplements or the things I'd learned from Iraq. But the thing is beginning to merge into a picture. Suddenly, this line is so important that for 2,000 years after Christ and for 2,000 years before Christ, for 4,000 years, this same order had been operative and its aims and functions are the same today as they were then, to support and perpetuate the royal bloodline. The kings of the early succession, the kings who became the pharaohs of Egypt, and the kings of Israel, the high kings of Judah, were originally the kings of Mesopotamia. We then look for traditions, and we find that the anointing ceremonies were identical. The kings, upon coronation, were anointed with the fat of the sacred dragon, the crocodile, referred to in Egypt as the holy messer, from which derived the Hebrew word to anoint. And the early kings of the period were called always dragons or messers, messiahs. That's where messiah comes from. It comes from the ancient holy crocodile. So when one talks about Jesus the Messiah, we actually have an anomaly there, because he's not the Messiah. He's one of a whole succession of messiahs. And these are pretty important people who are being looked after by a court of high priests, people looking after the bloodline. In times of battle, we're told, when different kingdoms are brought together to form an overall army, they appointed a head dragon, a head messiah, the King of Kings, and the name, in Celtic terms, became Pendragon. So we're beginning to see the names creeping in here of all the stuff we know about in Arthurian lore, with the Pendragon and the royal kingdoms. This started way, way back. We're suddenly into 2000 BC. We're now going to move back into 3000 and 4000 BC, and we find these same titles being used, dragons, messiahs, all the time. One of the things I learned from the order was actually the root of the word kingship. Not many of us think about it, do we? Kings are kings and queens are queens, and it doesn't mean a lot, that's what they are. The name goes back to the very, very earliest times. The records show that the central G in the word kingship, or the G on the end of king, is just the latter-day Western edition for the sake of making it easier to say and to differentiate it from another word, because the word kingship is absolutely identical with the word kinship. It means blood relative. A king is a blood relative, and that's all it means. In its original form, however, it's spelt differently. We haven't got kinship or kingship, we have kainship. And the first king of the dragon messianic succession is recorded in the documents of the order from 2200 BC to be the fellow that we know as the biblical Cain. Well, he's not actually too important in the story, is he, apart from killing his brother Abel and disappearing from sight? He turns out to be the founder of the greatest sovereign line in history. We can now begin to see the anomaly in the book of Genesis. The line from Seth, the third son of Adam and Eve, turns out not to be the important person in this succession at all. The important person is the guy that gets shunned and put aside, the first son of Eve, whose name is Cain. In fact, the records tell us that he was the Cain, the king. He was the first earthly high king of an area called Kish, which sits pretty near Babylon in Iraq. So two more things then suddenly come to look. The more you start looking now, the more begins to leap out from pages, just as it did with the New Testament stuff. Because the stories that we know, that we're taught from our schoolrooms, our pulpits, tell us about Cain and Abel, the two sons of Adam and Eve, and Cain slew Abel. Actually, when you look at the Bible and all the other texts of the period, they are not two sons of Adam and Eve at all. They are both sons of Eve. But only Abel turned out to be a son of Adam. Even the book of Genesis explains to us that Eve said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. Who was the Lord? The Lord was Enki. If we now begin to look at old Jewish literature again, we discover that there is nothing outside of our pulpit teaching that tells us that Adam was the father of Cain. We suddenly learn that Enki was the father of Cain. We have a situation that begins to repeat the Jesus type of experience. We actually have an original son of a God. We can look at the other jargon of the era, the way that the story gets told to us. We're told that Cain was tiller of the ground. Did the original text say that? Do they say he was a tiller of the ground? Well, not quite. What they actually say is that Cain had dominion over the earth. Well, it's not quite the same, is it? Can see how it gets translated to be something different, though. In fact, the Bible translators seem to have continually had a problem in translating the effective word for earth. They translated it to ground, to clay, to soil, to dust, and to all sorts of things, except what they should have translated it to was the earth. The earth, not that earth, the earth. Every time the word is mentioned to be translatable, they're referring to the earth. Even in the case of Adam and Eve, the translators get it wrong. The Bible says, male and female, he created them and he called their name Adam. The older records use the term Adamah, which means of earth. It did not mean they were made of dirt or clay or dust. It says, exactly as the Anchor Hebrew Bible now explains, clearly for us all to understand, they were of the earth, they were earthlings. So we're suddenly discovering there's a bit of a difference here now between the gods and the earthlings, and we know that earthlings, if something is called, it's not quite like the average person, because there's lots of other people around at the time, they're not called earthlings. So there's a difference. Here are people who for some reason or another are not gods, but they're not just ordinary living people, they're earthlings. There is a hell of a lot, and people here have probably read authors like Zachariah Sitchin and others. There's been a lot written about the sort of genetic engineering that went on at that time, about how characters of the era that may have ended up being called Adam and Eve or whatever were clinically cloned in some regard. I'm not actually going to dwell on that tonight. It's a part of my book, and I actually go much more fully into it than Sitchin and others. What I really want to do is to cut to the chase here and get on to the story of the bloodline. So we need to take that as read, that the Adam-Eve figures were the first of something. We know that they were the first of something. Everything tells us it was. And the Sumerian records themselves tell us that they were the first of something which they call the branches. And the word branches, the word for branches was clones. Spelt just like it is today, it means branches. So Adam's not the first man on earth, he's the first of a specifically devised strain of being, and his surrogate mother is actually named in the records of Iraq, and she's called Ninkursag. It means lady of life, lady of the embryo. She was the surrogate mother of Adam, and we find Adam actually recorded by the name Adam, Adama, Ataba, various formed the name as the very, very first king before Cain of this country called Ish. So we find that the bloodline is now beginning to have a little more significance. Not just wandering nomads, picking fruit off of trees and things, we're building up a kingly line here right from the start. It was because of Ninkursag's title, the Lady of Life, that Eve, or Ava as the records call her at the time, was subsequently given exactly the same name by the Hebrews, Lady of Life. It's said in the text that Eve actually means life. So that's where the title comes from. It comes from the goddess who was the Lady of Life. But there's something actually rather more strange here, because Eve's always called the Lady of the Rib as well. We get told how Adam's rib was pulled from his side and she was made from this rib. Well, that's an odd one, because Lady of Life in Sumerian, the word for Lady of Life was Ninti. There was another word pronounced T, a longer word than T, and that meant rib. And the Hebrews actually didn't seem to understand the difference between the two. So Ninti and Ninti became the same thing, and she became the Lady of the Rib, and it was really that simple. There's nothing else in the records to tell us anything about Adam's side and ribs and all of this sort of stuff. Lady of the Rib, Ninti, mistranslation for the Lady of Life. So we now have Enki, and we now have Enlil, and we suddenly discover that this Ninkursag woman, this goddess, this Lady of Life, is their sister. And they're both married to the sister. It is rule of matriarchal kingship as applied at the time, the same rule that subsequently got made the rule on earth. Kings married their first, second sister, or first or second cousins. And it seems to suddenly become apparent that this is being done to perpetuate something quite specific in the bloodline. Those who have read books about ancient Sumer and the gods of the time will know that the great pantheon of the era were called the Anunnaki. These were the gods of the time. In Canaan, they called them Elohim. In fact, the court of the Elohim, the court of the Anunnaki, the Grand Assembly, as it was called in those days, is actually mentioned in the Bible. If we look at Psalm 82, we discover Jehovah actually making an appearance at this court before the other gods and trying to claim supremacy. So even the Bible tells us that he wasn't the only one. Cain was important, we discover, because he's actually the son, not of Adam and Eve, but of Enki and Eve. We actually have here, if we use the word that they used, the word clone, or clone, the branch, we have a second stage in the cloning fertilization process. We have now not only a partly contrived Eve, who is 50% Anunnaki, we now have Eve and Enki, who is wholly Anunnaki, and a son that turns out, according to the records, to be at least three-quarters Anunnaki. We have a man who's very much approaching a god figure himself. The records actually say that Cain's blood was so advanced that his brother Hevel, the brothers Hevel, Abel, we know him, his brother Hevel's blood was earthbound by comparison. That's what the records say. His blood was so advanced that his brother's blood was earthbound. What does our Bible say? Cain rose up against Abel and spilled his blood on the ground. It actually comes from a translation of rose up. Cain rose so high above Abel, we're told. So we get told he rose up against him and spilled his blood on the ground. That is not what the records say at all. There is no story anywhere outside of our Bible teaching that indicates that whatsoever. So we're moving into sovereign history. We have a bloodline which has been contrived. It's being contrived for leadership among men in a very special way. The gods of the time are actually trying to implant whatever it is they have that's so special into this nuclear race, the new leaders, the Cains, the kings, the kin. So we can now progress our story to what now becomes, and this is something in the records of the Dragon Court, the very, very first grant of royal arms, heraldry, in sovereign history. the grant of arms, which denoted the messianic bloodline for all time, today as then. The Sumerians refer to this insignia as the Grail. Grail. Familiar, isn't it? Grail, when you put it together. The Holy Grail. The Bible calls it the Mark of Cain. The mark is portrayed to us by the church as if it was some sort of a curse. The Lord thrust the mark upon Cain, but why did he do it? It says he did it to save him being killed by his enemies. At that moment in time, we're supposed to believe that Adam has killed, that Cain's killed Abel, and apart from his mother, there's nobody else on earth anyway, but now he has a mark to protect him from his enemies. What enemies? Well, in fact, we know that Cain got into an argument with Jehovah, this is the way the story goes, over allegiance problems, venerations. There was a dispute about who should offer veneration to Jehovah and who shouldn't. It was not Cain's prerogative to offer veneration to Jehovah because he was the son of Jehovah's brother. It then tells us that the Lord placed a mark upon Cain to save him from his enemies, a sevenfold vengeance. Who was the Lord? The Lord was not Jehovah. The Lord was his brother, Enki. So we find, in fact, what the dragon court has recorded for all time, something called the first grant of arms in sovereign history, when Lord Enki grants to his son the Grail, the Mark of Cain. What is the Mark of Cain? It is the most simplest of all sovereign devices. It is very simply, and the Phoenician records tell us this, the early Hebrew records tell us this, the Mesopotamian records tell us this, and they all tell us the same symbol. It is very simply an upright red cross within a circle. A very familiar image. A red cross in a circle. It's called the Grail. Why was it called the Grail? Because we know the Grail to be something else. A Grail is a chalice, or a Grail is a bloodline, or whatever we spoke about in our previous talks. Well, it's rather odd, because this emblem, although it's a cross within a circle, is defined as the dew cup. The dew cup. The cup of the waters. This is rather interesting, because when one gets into Grail lore of medieval times, we always have ladies of the waters, ladies of the fountain, things like water's terribly important here in this early sovereign history. The Mark of Cain is the dew cup, the cup of the waters, which in the sort of Greco-Roman language of early times was called Rosi Crucis. Rosi dew crucis cup, Rosi Crucis, from whence comes Rosicrucians. The dew cup, the Grail, an upright red cross. Even today, the dragon court uses the same emblem. It's a little more advanced, it's a little more pretty, but it's the identical emblem to what they had then. So Cain is now king. Cain has a grant of arms. What do we do to perpetuate his bloodline? What do we do to make his heirs and successors even more special? We now have to marry him back into the godly line. He marries a woman, the records tell us, called Luliva. The Bible doesn't give us this name. It tells us about his offspring, but it doesn't give us her name. Other records do. Luliva. It names their son in the Bible, Enoch. Other records name his other son, Atun. The Sumerian records tell us that Atun was the successor of Cain. That's the reason why he's not mentioned in the Bible. Only Enoch is. Atun was the successor. Atun as Etana was the next high king of Kish. So we're now beginning not only a royal bloodline, we're actually beginning to see the very first kingly dynasty on earth. Kings, earthlings, Adamas, highly bred people meant to be leaders among humankind. We keep seeing them referred to as the fruit and the branches of the vine. In latter-day times, the Holy Grail is often referred to as a vine of grapes. The word keeps coming up. These people are Cains, these people are clones. Now, today we use the clone in quite a different form, but it almost means the same thing, specially contrived to be of a kind. K-L-O-N-E in the old spelling. So by virtue of this contrived breeding, what we have is a specifically modelled succession beginning to build up in history. A succession which, judging by their military prowess, judging by their political influence, judging by their leadership at the great assemblies, seem to have a much more heightened awareness than the norm. In terms of culture and wisdom and general intuition, there is no doubt that these people were advanced. His blood was so advanced that he rose above his brother. This seems to be the story throughout the generations. The senior people in this line are really beginning to look quite special. And this is the line that is finally going to end up with King David and eventually with Jesus. It was recognized at the time, however, that there was more to it than just producing a line and dealing with its diet and its general health. What they do seem to know about, and they make a very big thing of it, they don't call it the same thing, but it would be what we call today DNA. And they record very, very specifically that the important gene that moves through this from generation to generation is strictly a female gene. The DNA structure that gives the ability for true kingship comes through the mother, always. The best that latter-day Judaism managed to do to hang on to this tradition was to claim that being a Jew was something that happened because of your mother. It doesn't matter too much about your father. If your mother's a Jew, you're a Jew. This was set up in the kingly line. If the mother had to be part of the great queenly succession for the son to succeed as a king. So at whatever stage the king was, whether it was Cain or whether it was his son Atun or whoever following that, they were always married back into a princessly line that was really well strictly and wholly Anunnaki. Not Adamas and Earthlings at all, straight back into the godly race. So in fact, every time the line got stronger and stronger and stronger. True kingship, it was maintained. True kinship was inherited through the mother. So we can now begin to see why it was that, just like with the New Testament, history gets contrived in a different way, because just like the Roman Church, as we talked about in our previous discussion, just like the Roman Church built up a religion based on vested interests that was to keep women out of positions of authority in society and the church, the Jews had earlier done exactly the same thing. They had built up a male-dominated religion, and they had lost all trace of this real importance of the kingly heritage coming through the women from the early days. We discover, getting back to my original findings about the possibility of something dietary going on here, from this point, from the time of Cain's son Etana, we suddenly discover the mention of something called the plant of life. These people are being fed from the plant of life. It's from the plant of life that this word branches and vine keeps getting mentioned, from which we get the clones. The plant of life is the root of this. This is going to turn out to be the key of what was special about the bloodline. Why was it then that the Jews decided to knock that on the head and to forget it and to tell us a tale about wandering, territory-seeking nomads, when what they had to tell was the greatest story in the whole of history? Be born as earthlings from gods. We're told that the line came from Seth, the line came down to Noah, the line came down to Abraham. What happened, I did wonder along the way, what happened to change the course of events? What happened in Jewish law or in Jewish custom to make them have to knock this early part of history on their head? There had to be a reason for it. They wouldn't have done it to get rid of something important. They would have done it to get rid of something that was a problem to them. Something must have happened. Maybe something happened around about the time of Noah. It's actually quite surprising. Often when you come up with an idea like that, and you think, this is the era we're looking at. We're looking at the era of Noah. So what happened then to make them make this change? Was there something? Is there something in the Bible? And we actually find that there is. What happened was that at the time of Noah, Jehovah, who they've taken on board to worship, wholly and solely, some centuries later, apparently said to the sons of Noah, "The lifeblood of the flesh thereof ye shall not eat." The blood ye shall not eat. This edict becomes expressly important to later Jewish law and the Jewish way of life. Why does Jehovah suddenly at that moment in time become obsessed with what to us seems like the intake of blood in some form or another? What's the problem here? It's a customary Jewish practice now to hang meat for bloodletting before consuming it and cooking it. What's odd is that in the Christian religion, something quite different happens. In the Christian religion, in contrast, it's actually customary to take what we know as the Mass or the Communion Sacrament, which takes us through a ritual of pretending to be drinking blood. We drink blood from a chalice. Why a chalice? This is Grail law coming into play. This is the old cup of the Jew, holy waters. Jews cannot and will not eat blood if they're observing the faith. The Christians pretend to. The blood of the Messianic line. This is my blood, the blood of Jesus, and drinking wine. So could it be, one wonders, that this Christian tradition has actually got more right than the Jewish tradition in terms of old law? Maybe the Christian tradition tending to drink blood is a throwback, a real throwback to some really ancient custom before the days of Noah. Could that be? Well, as it turns out, it is. It is exactly that. The other interesting thing is that we discover that every time what we might think of as blood drinking or blood eating is referred to in the early days, in the dietary stories, the sign that always gets presented to us is the red cross in the circle. Now, crosses in circles mean a lot of things, but red crosses in the circle are always tied up with this particular ritual, the dew cup, the cup of the waters, the Rosicrucius. However, it's always a cup, it's always a chalice that's involved. And from bloodline of the Holy Grail, what we learned with our investigations was that the chalice was the ultimate symbol of the female. One can go back to 4,000 BC and find the female symbol is a cup or a chalice. In its simplest form, it is simply this circle with the red cross in it. Could it be that this blood that we're talking about, that was suddenly such a problem, but is linked to the fact that kingship is only obtainable through the gene of the female, has something to do with menstrual blood? Is this the important factor here? Well, that's a bit hard to take when you think about it first, but the more you look, the more you find, and you only have to look at the Dragon Ball records from 2200 BC, and you find, yes, this is exactly what we're looking at. We're looking at early stages of bodily supplements. We're looking at stages before the drug companies came in. We're looking at times before alchemy and early laboratories and things like that. We're simply looking at things could be done with natural products. We begin to find an old ritual in Egypt, in Canaan, in Babylonia, in Mesopotamia, generally in Aden, down into Shumer, same ritual. It's called the ritual of the starfire. Starfire. It's a ritual which we're told began with Enki's sister Ninhursag. Ninhursag was the lady of the embryo, the lady of life, the lady who we are told fed her offspring with her starfire. We're looking at a ritual of menstrual blood. This is stunning stuff because it seems a little unsavory, doesn't it, to start with? I started to ask a few friends of mine and people that I knew who were doctors and scientists and people with drug companies, and I said, can you tell me what some of these medicines that we take today are made of? Can you actually tell me what the ingredients are, for example, for this or for this or for this? And they told me a few of these things, and suddenly starfire seemed a pretty good bet. It was not so frightening after all. We actually are in the habit of taking some very, very strange stuff without knowing it because it looks like a little white pill. The divine starfire. Suddenly, the more you look for it, the more you find it. And every time you find it, you find the circle with the red cross, the cup of the dew, the cup of the holy waters, the cup that overflows. Keep finding as well the importance of the female line. We find all sorts of strange words being used, but all the time we're talking about genes, genetic construction, DNA. They tell us that Ninkursag, the Lady of Life, was also known in Egypt as Isis. Isis, the great mother, the model for the virgin mother with her child Horus. Isis is the great mother. Isis is the woman of the gene. Isis is Ninkursag. Isis is the lady of gene. Isis, Genesis. The Greeks called it Genesis. It was originally a split word. And in the earliest versions of the Septuagint that I can find, it is gene Isis. The word for in the beginning in Jewish was quite different. The whole begins with it. It's not Genesis. Quite a different word. So before looking at this starfire practice in detail, which we shall, we must now remind ourselves that actually it was Jehovah Enlil who gave the instruction that blood must not be taken, and he gave it to Noah and the son of Noah, members of this kingly line. It was Jehovah that gave this edict. It was not his brother Enki who had fathered this line. It would appear that for a good while they actually didn't take too much notice at all. If Jehovah didn't like it, Jehovah could bring a flood or something. They didn't actually have to obey. It wasn't until much later that they decided to obey this guy all the time. The starfire practice seemed to continue for quite a long time, and it is this that begins to make the line important. Noah, Abraham, and the others, these were all products of clone and starfire, kings of very, very high repute in a line, not from Seth, but from Cain. Why now we can understand, did we have a contrived line from Seth and not the line from Cain? Because by contriving a line from Seth down to Noah, we got rid of it being Cainship, starfireship. We knocked it out of the ball game completely, because all of a sudden, we weren't taking blood. But if this was an edict from Jehovah, then probably it actually wasn't to their benefit. Starfire was called the great lunar essence of the goddess. Actually, even in everyday mundane environments, I've discovered now this starfire stuff is pretty potent. I decided to have, again, friends of mine at the hospital tell me what was really here. Is this important stuff? They said, if it was food, it is the most potent life force on Earth. And clearly we know that, because it happens because of bringing life onto Earth. Producers of starfire, the goddesses who held themselves in position for this particular function for the kingly line, were designated the flowers. Flowers. Which actually was written flowers. It is exactly where our word flower comes from. The flower was the flower, and the flower was always the lily, and the lily was the key to the name of just about everybody in that line. A version or a variation of lily, just like Lulava was the wife of Cain. Lulava, again from a base of lily. From lily we have Lulava, we have Lilith, we have Lulu, we have Lilette. What actually, I ask my doctor friends, is really so special about starfire? What is so special about this food that, if not used, ends up being menstrual blood? It holds, they said, the greatest of all bodily secretions from certain glands, from the pineal gland, from the pituitary gland, certain parts of a brain function that give us specific levels of awareness and intellect. All of the things that the kingly line needed. What was actually happening was that instead of them relying solely on their own glandular production of secretions and hormones, they were being fed with enhancements for this. Just like we take hormone replacement therapy and other bodily supplements today. But they were taking it at a very, very advanced level, because this is not earthly stuff, this is Anunnaki starfire, straight from the goddesses. What we suddenly find is that because of the impact that this has on glands like the pineal, we're not only feeding the body more substances like melatonin and serotonin, we're actually causing the glands within those kingly people themselves to begin to produce more of these hormones. They are punching this stuff out like crazy, and they are living for very, very long times. All of a sudden, the great ages of this patriarchal line in the Bible begin not to look so strange after all. Because when one looks at the historical record of exactly the same family, these same numbers of years keep appearing. They lived for hundreds of years. And it was said that this was exactly because of this practice. Well, it's no secret really, actually, it hadn't occurred to me before. But when one studies the importance of glands like the pineal and melatonin production, even today, we know that there are within these secretions keys to anti-aging. They have anti-aging properties. Well, they were actually using them. They were making really good use of it. And they were making sure that their kings lived for a very, very long time. The interesting thing is that once one steps outside of this line and looks at parallel families, these ages aren't there at all. These ages are as normal as anybody else's. The great ages in the line continued way past Noah for a few generations. And not until we get to the time of Abraham and beyond, suddenly the life patterns begin to change in the line. The ages begin to become more normal. Isaac lived for 110 years, and we're gradually coming down the tree, and soon we're into people living 70 years and 80 years and pretty ordinary sort of lifespans. So what we can judge by this is that we have actually hit it on the head, that it's around Abraham's time, not Noah's time, that they began to take notice of thou shalt not take the lifeblood. They were beginning to pull off of it. So we have a situation, we have a line now coming down, and it supposedly goes from Abraham down to David, but actually it's ceasing to become very special. So why is it so special when it gets to David? Well, perhaps it went somewhere else, came back, and it actually did. Because it transpires that from exactly that strain from Noah before the time of Abraham, the line had already branched out, and the line had already become the early kingdoms and pharaohs of Egypt. And when one looks at their lifespans again, they seem to go on for a very, very long time. In fact, some of them go on for so long that there are records of deaths and certainly no evidence of any tombs. Goodness knows what happened to them. It simply disappeared. Flowers and flowers. The plant of life, the flower, it was said, was a lily who gave us the nectar of supreme excellence. which the Greeks called later soma. Soma is related to life, to longevity. So why dragons? We know that the Messiah was a dragon. We know that the crocodile was the root of the dragon. We know that the dragon order was founded in 2200 BC. We know that the word dragons and pendragons actually comes from way back about 3800 BC. Why isn't the symbol a dragon? Why is the symbol this red cross? Well, in actual fact, one discovers that the symbol is a dragon. The red cross, the dewcup, is a dragon. The circle it transmits is a serpent, clutching its own tail, creating everlasting, the unity. So suddenly, the dragon is linked with the dewcup, is linked with the Holy Grail, and it's why Grail kings were still called in the Middle Ages pendragons. The symbol was the same, and as one progresses through history and follows the Red Cross symbol, it gradually emerges that this is actually a dragon, and it's more pictorially displayed, but it was always that. It was always a dragon, and the dragon was called Draco, Draco the dragon. It was the emblem of the pharaohs. The dragon, it was the emblem of the Egyptian Therapeutate at Qumran in the time of Jesus. It was the Bestia Neptunis, the great sea serpent of the Merovingian Fisher Kings in France, and it is the emblem of most of the royal families today, somewhere on their coats of arms, the dragon, Draco. Draco is identical as a dragon with serpent because there's little relation between these fire-breathing, winged dragons that we see in nursery rhyme. The dragon was originally more like a crocodile. It was a four-legged, rather large, snouted serpent. Serpent and dragon were absolutely identical, and it didn't really matter which word was used, it meant the same thing. The dragon, the holy crocodile, the messer, the messiah. The word serpent is used many, many times in the Bible. It starts off with the story of Adam and Eve and the serpent in the garden. Dragon in the garden. Every time we see the word serpent in the Bible, when we look back at the original Hebrew writings to see what it was translated from, it was translated from a word that with vowels in it comes to something like Nahash. N-H-S-H, continentally. The word meant to decipher. It meant to divine. It meant to find out. It had nothing whatever to do with snakes. The dragon was always he who held the knowledge, he who from one found out, he whom could divine, and that is the root of why we call gods and deities divine, because they held the roots of the serpent, of the Nahash, to the divining. They had the knowledge, they had the knowing, they were the kings, and the serpent of the garden, we are told, was Enki. Serpents, from that time on until today, are always, always associated with wisdom and with knowledge. They're not evil. They've never been evil in any law except Christian and latter-day Jewish law. They were wisdom. They were healing. They were knowledge. It's interesting to discover, once one starts to look, how often serpents and dragons appear in motifs of healing institutions today. The American Medical Association is actually the plant of life, a tree staff with a winding serpent around it. Once one looks a little further into that, it's more interesting to see that there are more complex medical devices using serpents. The one that we actually know, perhaps, is the winged caduceus of Hermes with the two coiling serpents around it. This, actually, is not just the emblem of medical associations worldwide today. It was actually one of the earliest symbols of the early dragon court. It was the emblem of the Essene Therapeutate at Qumran at the time of Jesus, and the records tell us exactly what it is. The theory that this is a winged Caduceus is a myth. It has very little to do with Hermes or with Mercury. The records tell us that the staff that stands centrally is the spinal column. The nervous system are the coiling serpents that go around it. The two wings at the top are the ventricles of the brain, left and right, and that little spot in between is the pineal gland. The gland, the wings, the top of the stem are referred to in the oldest of law, and even certain yogis and people use the term today, it's called the swan. This was the order of the swan that great Grail knights such as Lohengrin and Parsifal belongs to, and it is still a flourishing knightly order today. It is a knightly order for those who are still partaking of the equivalent, in today's terms, of starfire. I don't have to tell you too much, I suppose, about pineal glands and things like that, but for the benefit of a few who might not have read too much, the gland is small, it's tiny, it sits between the two left and right sides of the brain. It doesn't form part of the brain matter, but it's part of it, it's central. It sits in the back and it's sort of in the middle here and looks straight through the front. It's called the third eye sometimes. What it does is to produce the hormone, the secretion that gives many of the qualities that were actually purposely fed back into this bloodline. Melatonin and the pituitary gland produces serotonin, all important for longevity, all important for intuition, important for awareness, important for just about every aspect of supreme and superior leadership. They were called, even then, people of the swan. They were also serpents, they were also dragons, they were also kings of the Grail, Grail Dew Cup. And it's why this mythology creeps on even to the modern times. We can get into the Middle Ages, we can get into Arthurian lore all the time. We have chalices, we have ladies of the fountain, ladies of the flow, ladies of the waters. We have dragons, we have pendragons. All of these names crop up, and these names exist in one form or another going back for 5,000 years. In the days of ancient Sumer, we can find records, and there are tens of thousands of records from that are now available that have been translated in the last 50 years, that actually explain that the priests of Anu, who was the father of Enki and Enlil, the priests of Anu perfected and elaborated a ramifying medical science of living substances. And it tells us that the most important of these, the treatment of just about anything, was menstrual starfire from the Anunnaki goddess. They called it the gold of the gods. It was used as medicine, but it was fed daily and regularly to the kings of the succession. In Egypt and Mediterranean in later times, we discover that the ritual progresses. This is beyond the days of Anunnaki now. Starfire becomes a priestly activity. There are bred for the purpose within the temples, virgin priestesses who exist only for the purpose of producing the starfire. And they are called scarlet women. They are granted always the names of Lily, Lilutu, and Lilette, and the other names. These are their temple names, just as they used to be in ancient Sumer, but we're now earthly priestesses, very highly bred, specifically for the purpose. The red of cross now becomes given a name, and the red of the cross is called Ritu. It's actually not an Egyptian name, it was an Asian name, but it was called Ritu. Ritu was the gold of the gods. Ritu is the word from which we actually get red and ritual, and indeed root. And red Ritu was defined as red gold of the golden fire. So suddenly we begin to get something new happening here. We're beginning to get the words red and gold tied up together. They don't mean the same thing at all, but red is now gold, and gold is now red, and the red is the gold of the gods, and the Ritu practice becomes the ritual. Once one moves into this realm of learning that ritual comes from the collecting of the Ritu, the starfire, you begin to find a whole sequence of events that lead to many of the words that we have today. One of the first things that we see is that red also is synonymous with black. I'm not quite sure why, but whenever black is mentioned, it means the same as red, and whenever red is mentioned, it means the same as black. Even in India, the goddess Kali was said to be both red and black, and still is in various traditions. Now, Kali Math, who was the original model for the Indian goddess Kali, Kali Math, was the sister of Lulava, the wife of Cain. Kali Math was strictly Anunnaki. And Kali Math, we are told, was black. Kali Math, we are told, was red. Kali Math, we are told, was a scarlet woman. And Kali Math becomes, not too strangely, Kali, the goddess of times and seasons and periods and cycles. In the early days, therefore, we're looking at something that is going to evolve into a specific area of what we later became to call alchemy. It's not whole of alchemy, it's a little part of it. But we can now see where it's going. We can now see that we're dealing with a natural substance that eventually has to become a purposely contrived drug, for want of a better word, something else. Because actually, this Anunnaki starfire is not going to be around forever, which it wasn't. What does starfire do? It produces hormonal secretions. Who were the people that knew about these secretions? They were the people who knew these secretions. It's where the word secret comes from. It comes from the early priests, the temples of the dragon court, who kept the secret, the secretions. And this was one of the key secrets, really, of the early mystery schools, was the upholding of the starfire ritual. It is one of the secrets that Freemasonry says have been lost. They know that there's a secret somewhere back in ancient Egypt and Sumeria, but they're not quite sure what it is. Well, this is one of the secrets, the secret of the secretion, of the ritual, of the ritual. Are there any other words, we wonder? There actually are. In fact, there's an end to them. Once you start looking, we can suddenly find that this English language of ours that we thought came from bits of Latin and bits of Greek, of course, does. Where did they come from? They came from ancient Egypt and ancient Sumer and all these other countries, and the words keep piling in, not just ritual and secret, but other words as well. Coal is black. Coal comes from Bath coal. Who was Bath coal? Bath coal was what the Jews called Kali. Kali, coal, black. The women who were the scarlet women, the priestesses, were said to be the women of the voice. They were actually producing the wisdom of tomorrow. They had the voice. They produced the starfire. The womb was therefore the utterer of the word, the utterer, the uterus. It goes on and on. In fact, you wouldn't believe how many words come out of this stuff. Scarlet women. We all know what they are, don't we? Or at least we thought we did until just now. The Greeks called the Scarlet Women, these great priestesses of the starfire, Hierodulae, which actually got sort of shortened via medieval French into English to the word harlot. The Germans, old Germanic languages from Saxony and other countries, had a word hores, H-O-R-E-S in modern terms, which actually was anglicized whores. Scarlet women, hierodulae, whores, harlots, whatever, all the same things. And every one of those words, whores, hierodulae, whatever, translates back to the same thing, dearly beloved one. There is no connection whatever. And really, the good dictionaries still tell us this if we care to look. There is no, not even the slightest vestige of similarity between the word whore and harlot and, say, prostitute or adulteress. They are not linked in any way. All words tell us what they mean, and those words mean dear beloved one. Scarlet women, sacred priestesses of the starfire. So when did it go? When did we suddenly forget all this stuff? Why was it so important? Why did we suddenly just have people who bled their meat and weren't of much consequence, really, until later days? It actually happened when the Latter-day descendants, whether in the Jewish tradition or in the later Christian tradition, decided to actually start forging history. Not just translating it, interpreting it to suit a vested interest of the moment. The one thing in the Jewish faith, as in the Christian faith, that was absolutely predominant was that any importance played by the female had to go. Not on. This is male stuff now. Priests, that's what we are. So it gets lost. Not because it necessarily has to, but because suddenly history has become religion. Not just religion, but a faith of fear. A religion based on venerating a guy who brings floods and famines and destruction. You don't do as you're told. Or so they thought. The Rosicrucius, the Jew cup, the mark of the later Rosicrucians, is all based on starfire ritual. It is why the Christian church, without knowing it, takes us through a ceremony that it doesn't understand when we pretend to drink blood from the chalice. It had all sorts of names. It was nectar of the gods. It was gold of the gods. It was also called the ceremony of the light. Now we're moving into areas that we begin to understand here. The way to the light, following the light, we suddenly look at the Essene records and the records from the Dead Sea Scrolls and whatever, and suddenly we're into a whole new scheme of operations which is pursuing the route to the light. The light, when we look back at the old records, actually was the starfire. The starfire is about the acquisition of ability to have special knowledge and wisdom. This is the light. This is the starfire. This is the root to it. And that had gone because it had been taken away. We're now looking for it. The light, it is said, exists in everybody. It simply has to be awakened. There are various ways of awakening it, but the natural way, we are told in the oldest records I can find, is simply by will. Self-will is the route to the light, a thought-free consciousness, a plane of pure being. And they called this plane of pure being the plane of Sharon. It was actually this very concept of being. Being through the starfire, being I am that I am, that became the problem for Jehovah, when the edict against blood was issued. Even after Adam was said to have taken from the tree and eaten of the fruit, God in the Bible, Jehovah, says, "Look here, guys, the man has become one of us." Those are the words, nearly. Behold, actually, behold. That's the sort of stuff God said, behold. He has become one of us. He has taken from the plant of life. He has taken the star fire. He has taken the fruit. The teachings of the early dragon school are very, very specific about being or self-completeness. It was the key to everything that this succession was built up on. It's actually not too far adrift from what you guys are about today. You're doing it through a very different means, but what in actual fact you are doing is through the type of training that you're going through and the type of processes that you put your own mind through, you are actually, in your own way, creating higher production of these hormonal secretions which are enabling you to move into higher realms than there would be norm in terms of cultural thinking. Behold, said Jehovah, man is one of us. This is an interesting quote, and I think we'll have a little break after this just to get ourselves comfortable and do whatever we have to do. But this might interest you, this quote. This quotation comes from 2200 BC. And it's not too far adrift from the sort of things that we're talking about here today. Nothing, it said, is achieved by wanting. Nothing is achieved by relinquishing responsibility to a higher authority. Belief is the act of be living, for to be live is to believe. Belief is be living. Belief is beliving. The will is the ultimate medium of the self. This is the root to the knowledge, it said. This is the root of the personal God, because the personal God is within, and the self is God, the absolute consciousness, the Kia, I am that I am. Okay, we'll just have a little break now. The next half's a bit longer. After that, we'll have a few questions, and then there's somebody that wants to take me off on a different track altogether. So we'll see you in about 15 minutes.